Welcome to my course on game theory. My name's Matt Rozu. I'm teaching game theory this semester at Susquehanna University. I'm also putting on the video lessons all here, so anybody who's interested can learn a little bit about this really fantastic topic that helps give you insight into ways to think about, well, the world, essentially. So if you think you might enjoy this, you could check out some of the previous videos. Today we're talking sequential games. You don't necessarily need to have viewed the previous videos to catch this, although those are, if you like game theory, you should check those out also. So for today's topic, we're talking sequential games. As the term implies, sequential, we're dealing with games that there is a sequence of events, and this is in contrast to simultaneous games, so where all of the decisions are made either exactly at the same time or, you know, without knowing what the other person is doing. So we've looked at a game show decision where, you know, you could split or steal a prize. That's a simultaneous game. Sequential games, there are sequence of events. These happen often in the real world. And we're going to start by watching a clip from Survivor. This is actually from season one, the immunity challenge from Survivor. We're going to go ahead and watch that clip right now.
This challenge is very simple in its nature and its execution. We're calling it Hands on the Immunity Idol. And the challenge is to simply keep your hand on that idol as long as you can. The last person remaining with a hand on the idol wins immunity going into tonight's vote. So although you can't move your hands, you can lift your feet. Just don't let your hand come off of this. Good luck to you guys. Hang in there as long as you can. The last person standing gets immunity. And we are now beginning.
I have a request for 69 bottles of beer. Anybody others?
What would your wife think right now if she could have a picture in here of you in this mud volcano war paint holding a piece of wood?
Walking through fire.
She'd probably shake her head as usual and walk away, you know. He's doing something dumb again, you know.
The whiff.
I thought we could just hold it.
No. You know, when you're finished, they'll be here for you.
How about if we hold them without eating them?
Yeah, that'd be nice. But,
keep getting that inspiration from the smell.
You don't want to smell? They smell.
I know what oranges smell
like.
Like
oranges.
Oh, you don't know what these oranges smell like.
I don't need to.
You're sure? Permeate your soul?
I'm thinking oatmeal, Jeff.
I'll just put yours here, Rich.
Time for a speech.
Okay, Rich, let's have it.
I'm thinking I'm probably never going to outlast you, Kelly. I'm going to hope that either one of you just recognize what I've done to get here.
Si, senor.
I wish you both luck.
Rich! Oh, my gosh.
So are you going to make a long speech?
Not long, I said. A speech.
Let me just throw an idea out that just occurred to me. You said earlier that you guys have the alliance, maybe the strongest one. Yeah, you just kind of hopped out of this game well over 2 hours ago, leaving Rudy to carry the ball for at least 6, 7, 15, 20 hours.
That. I didn't think it would go this long.
Swap.
You take his hand off.
I think that's that, brother.
Yeah, I'm done. Nice job.
Nice job.
Nice job.
Nice job.
Look, time.
Oh,
there you go. Five in
that's
a row.
That's a record.
Okay, so about a 4-minute clip of kind of condensed of the immunity challenge from season one in Survivor, where, skip forward about a minute if you don't want any spoilers on this. But Richard Hatch chose not to continue anymore. He ended up winning. And the sequential game part of this is actually pretty fascinating because Richard Hatch was thinking through... there are three people left, and what will happen in the final vote if he happened to win the immunity challenge or not win the immunity challenge? So he had an agreement with the older gentleman that they would always vote for each other when they were, you know, or they would always support each other at all times. If the older gentleman was pretty loved by everybody. So Richard Hatch faced a dilemma here. If he won the immunity challenge, he got to choose who to vote out. He either votes out the person everybody loved, and by voting out the person everybody loved, that means, one, he broke his promise, that person won't vote for him. And because he broke his promise, he probably loses, you know, he does not win the $1 million within Survivor, the grand prize. If he votes out, the lady playing the game, the other person was so beloved, he loses the $1 million. The only way Richard Hatch could win was by not winning the immunity challenge and making it into the final two. And he figured that out, and that was a sequential game. And so that makes it pretty fascinating in my mind. I did not watch much of season one of Survivor. You know, it was new, it was coming on, it was super popular then for those who are a little bit younger. But towards the end, I caught this and I thought, wow, this is really, really fascinating in the way that this is a sequential game and he thought through the sequential game accurately. So kind of a little way to kind of get us thinking about games that have sequences involved. So, sequential games are usually represented in what we call extensive form. Extensive form, it's a tree diagram or decision tree, and it shows the sequence of events that are happening. There are a whole bunch of things we're going to note about tree diagrams and extensive form games that we just kind of need to understand as we move along. So first, the decisions are made at what we call decision nodes. At each decision node, there's a possible action, and there has to be at least two actions that can be taken. If there's only one action, it's not really much of a decision. If you're at a particular spot and there is literally only one possible thing you can do, it's not really much of a decision. So there has to be at least two, but there could be more than two actions that could be taken by a particular player in the game. Each action is denoted by a branch, right? Tree diagram, branches of the tree diagram. Very clever, of course. There are players in a game, as we know. The party taking the action, the player who is making the decision, is indicated at the decision node. So you would indicate the player's name or whatever the, you know, however the player is denoted at a particular decision node. Note, sometimes people other than the players in the games can influence the action. And if that is the case, we would just call that player nature. And maybe you could give a fancier name for it. That taking nature literally, suppose you have a football game. And there is a decision on whether or not to kick a field goal. Well, nature being the wind could actually influence that. And if there are wind gusts, you can't really control. And it's kind of blind luck. The outside, the nature, could have a gust that helps or harms a kick. It might not. You don't know. It's an action taken by an outside player. As you go through and solve the games and get to the end of the game, there are outcomes. So the outcome will be the set of choices that everybody made within a particular game. So at the end of all the decisions, it's an outcome, and there is an outcome. You know, at the outcome, there are what we call payoffs for each player. So if you are in a game and the offense puts in a particular lineup and the defense decides to defend against the run, you'd say offense put in the three wide receiver lineup, defense defends against the run. That's the outcome. Well, at that particular outcome, then there's payoffs. The payoffs could be the perhaps the expected number of yards gained if we're talking about an NFL game, right? The outcome, what is the outcome? What are the decisions made? The payoff is, you know, what was the value of the particular outcome for each particular player. So each player gets their own payoff. Each outcome should have a unique history, so you should be able to trace back. And that's really important as we are going to be solving these games by what we call backward induction. So we need to be able to trace back all the actions within a particular game. Now, sometimes within games, you know, there will be an action that's taken where a player won't have perfect information. Player will be taking an action and not know what happened before. That when that happens, we would refer to that as an information set. With an information set, if a player is taking an action and they're not sure what happened before, you simply draw a circle around the various choices. We're going to show some examples soon of what this might look like. Similarly, if there are any, if it's a simultaneous move within a sequential game, which of course could happen, right? You could have a sequence of events and then something that happens at the same time. A simultaneous move within a sequential game is also denoted by an information set. Another thing to note, every single extensive form game could be written as a normal form game. Now, often it could be clumsy to do this. You know, it might make much more sense to be in a sequential game or to be in a tree diagram, I'm sorry. Tree diagrams make much more sense often in sequential games because it can denote the sequence. Whereas a normal form game, you're in a payoff matrix. It doesn't really show you the sequence of events nearly as well. Final property point that we'll indicate here is the presence of what we call subgames. So within the full tree diagram of, you know, the entire sequential games, there are what we would call subgames, which is the game within the game. So any time there's a particular decision to be made and then there's a set of decisions, you know, a decision to be made that would be thought of as a subgame within the game. So each game that is sequential will actually have various subgames unless all of the decisions made after are made either without complete information or simultaneously. So essentially then there are always, more than one subgame within a particular game. So talked a little bit here about the properties of games, which I know isn't necessarily the most exciting thing to start with, but it's important. Let's look at a game, and I'm asking if you can spot the errors in these tree diagrams. I'm bringing this up. Believe it or not, I do not hire a professional artist to write these out, right? This is my own handwriting. I know you're stunned, but. So let's do a sequential game where you have a parent really needs their kid to behave, and they have a choice. They could offer their child a snack, or they could say no, the kid's not getting a snack that day. And then the child has a decision between behaving and not behaving. And let's just say that the parent really wants the kid to behave. It would, in a perfect world, would prefer not to give their kid a snack. Reliance on snacks, trying to have the kid eat nutritiously. The child, well, behaving's no fun, so they'd rather not behave. And snacks are fun, so they'd rather get the snack. So, what is wrong with this? You can pause it, take a moment. There should be two errors. There should be two errors that you can spot with this. Okay, so what are the two errors? First, remember, so the games are made at decision nodes, right? We see that. The root node is usually denoted with an open circle and then filled in little circles after that. So that part's okay. Our tree diagram has the branches where the actions are denoted. That's okay. At each decision node, the player taking the action should be noted. We see the parent first, then we see the child, but this is blank, and that is one of the errors in the game, right? We should be writing that this is the child's decision here as well. The other error, our game concludes after the parent offers the snack or not, and the child chooses to behave or not. So those we have the outcomes, right? Offer snack, behave would be an outcome. Offer snack, don't behave would be another outcome. No snack, behave, and no snack, don't behave. Those are the four possible outcomes, but it doesn't list the payoffs for those outcomes. I've put these in green, and I put monetary payoffs that I thought made a little bit of sense, given the preferences for both the parent and the child. So those were the two errors, right? Child should have been denoted at both decision nodes, not just one. Payoffs should have also been listed. Okay, that's all for this video introducing you to sequential games. In the next video, we will go through how to solve sequential games using backward induction. See you in the next video.